Good morning, good morning. How's everybody this morning? I just want to thank God that we have an opportunity to just worship Him. Mm-hmm. And He said that the true sons of God are those who worship Him in spirit and mm-hmm. in truth. I just want to thank everybody that's going to be listening in today. We have a wonderful lesson today. The Word became flesh. Coming out of John, the first chapter, verses 1 through 14. So we're going to go ahead and get started. And this morning, I just want to just let everyone know that you know, God says that He is a present help in the time of need. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And this morning's scripture that I'm going to read is coming out of Psalms 32, verse 8. I'm reading out of the New Living text. The Lord says, I will guide you along the best pathway for your life. I will advise you and watch over you. Amen. And that's a promise that we can hold on to, that He will guide us along the best pathway, the mm-hmm. best pathway for our life. Mm-hmm. He says, I will advise you and watch over you. Father, we thank you that we know that we have a help. And our help doesn't come from the mountain, but our help comes from the Lord. And we understand that, God. And so today, God, we're asking that you would just settle down right now in a real way, God. Let us know, God, that you are here with us, that you care. Let us know, God, that you're concerned about the things that we're going through. Because right now, Father, there's so many things that's going on, so many things that's taking place in our country, Lord, and in our states and our cities. And God, we want to just honor you, God, and acknowledge you, because when we do that, you said, seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, mm-hmm. and all those other things will be added unto us. So, Lord, as we seek you, we're praying and believing, God, that you will give us what we have need of. As we look into your word today, God, I pray, God, that you open up our eyes that we may be able to see. Open up our minds, Lord, that we'll be able to understand what your word has to say today. And we thank you so much in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 All right.
So we, you know, like I said, today's lesson is coming out of John chapter 1, verses 1 through 14. And let's go ahead and read that right now. 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God.
Mm-hmm.
The same was in the beginning with God.
Mm-hmm.
All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not.
Mm-hmm.
There was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not the light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world.
Mm-hmm.
He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave them power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for allowing us to just look into your word.
Mm-hmm.
Let's set the stage here. Now, we have some facts that we want to look at. To note that the eternal nature of Jesus, now that's a fact, the eternal nature of Jesus. And as the scripture says, that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. So there is an eternal nature, meaning that he was before time, and he's gonna be through time and to the end of time. And if there's ever an end, that's where he's gonna be.
Mm-hmm.
But he's with us all that time. And then he was actually here at the beginning of time. So, you know, try to get your mind wrapped around that. The principle is this: to praise the Lord for Jesus' incarnation, which is the real reason to celebrate Christmas. So, you know, over the years, you know, we have different reasons why we celebrate Christmas. And what's the real reason? Christ was born. He became flesh and dwelt among us. And that's what we need to understand, that it's not so much as the gift giving. I mean, and that's nice. It's not so much as acknowledging people. That's nice, too. But it's acknowledging and understanding the value and the true meaning of Jesus himself. The application is this: to correctly proclaim the biblical Jesus as recorded in John, which were the text that we're reading now, to the loss of our current generation. So if we're not actively proclaiming Jesus Christ to the lost, then we are missing the point. Because he came that we may give an example and give testimony, or as John the Baptist did, be a witness to him. And you know, we talked about this before, that some people will say, well, I don't know what to say. And just tell someone what he's done for you, or what he's doing for you. I mean, because you know what? We all, at one time or another, was in a mess. And he comes and he helps us straighten out the mess. And so when that occurs, or when that happens, you can talk about that, how he helped you to get from where you were to where you are now, or where you need to be. And he's working on you. Believe me, he's still working on me. The golden text is this: he was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. And that's John 1 verse 10. This lesson is broken up into three parts. The first part is the Word. The second part is the light. And the third part is the incarnation. So in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. was with God, and the Word was God. Now, these are three very important theological truths. And these same truths are also mentioned in Genesis chapter 1, the first part of the first verse. It says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and earth. So the idea that the Word existed before the creation of time, because in the beginning, God created the heavens and earth. So that's actually when we know, or when we can record when time started, but God was here before then. This shows that Jesus had a distinct personhood from the Father, because it says that, and when you look at this, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. So that means that Jesus is the Word. The Word was with God. And then he goes on to say the Word was God. So they're different, but then they are uniquely the same. And we're going to get a chance to understand that a little clearer as we go along. Nevertheless, he is of the same divine essence as the Father and the Spirit. So that's the Trinity in itself right there, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And so all three of them were distinctly different, but they are the same, uniquely the same, that makes up the Godhead bodily. So we want to understand that. Let's look at this. Was the Word? Did the Word have a beginning? And that's a question I want to ask you. Did the Word have a beginning? Because it says in the beginning was the Word. So we need to understand this, that no. John says no, that the Word didn't have a beginning. If we were to be able to reach back into anything, there was already the Word had already existed. So there was that, you know, we can't define, and maybe when we get to heaven and we can get to ask him a question, you know, like that, well, when did everything start? and he might answer your question. But I think that when we get to heaven, that we're going to be so caught up in praising him and worshiping him, that some of the questions that we think we want to ask him, that are not even going to matter when we get there. You know, they're going to be like, hey, I'm glad I'm here. You know, let's go ahead and join the choir and start singing. The word translated in the Greek is logos. Logos, and that's L-O-G-O-S, logos. The Greek understood this to mean the reason or an idea. The Jewish rabbi spoke of God himself as the Word of God. And so now we're going to be talking about, as we go along, we're going to be talking about how the Greeks perceive this. And we're going to be talking about how the Jews perceive this. So the Greeks understood the Word to mean reason or idea. The Jews or the rabbis, they spoke of God himself as the Word of God. And this is an example. In Exodus 19, verse 17, it says this, Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet God. Now, when you read that, you could also read it like this, that Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet the Word of God. And we need to understand that God always sent his Word, you know, and even back in the Old Testament, he sent his Word. And sometimes he called it the angel of the Lord, but he always sent his Word. He always sent his logos. And that word logos also is attached to power. And we're going to see that as we go along. So John, speaking to both the Jews and the Greeks, So you got to understand this, that the audience, what kind of audience did John have? You know, now he's out there, he came out of the wilderness, and he came proclaiming the good news, you know, prepare you the way of the Lord. Now, who was his audience that he was talking to? And we need to understand that his audience were the Jews and the Greeks. And so they had a different, whole different concept of how they perceived a lot of the things that was being taught and said. And that was not like that was a conflict, but John understood that he was talking to both of these entities or these groups of people. For centuries, you've been talking, and this is what he's saying to the Jews and to the Greeks. For centuries, you've been talking, thinking, and writing about the word, the logos. Now I will tell you who he is. The word became flesh. So this is what John is saying. He spoke to them in terms that they understood. The same was in the beginning with God. So he's saying, look, you've been talking about this, you've been writing about this. So they was very familiar with the fact that the word of God was coming. So John is saying, now this is the word right here. He became flesh and dwelt among us. Here's a practical point. Jesus Christ is God and has always been God. And I mean, how many different ways can we say that this morning? We're gonna say it a few different ways. But Jesus Christ has always been God, and he is God. And so and it's like this, I don't know about you, but sometimes when I'm praying, I will be talking to God. And then right in the middle of my prayer, I'm talking to Jesus. And then sometimes I switch over, I'm talking to the Holy Spirit. And so I understand that it doesn't matter which one I'm talking to, that they all understand that there's unity there. And that same unity that they have is the same unity that he's desiring that we have. So he's always been there. All things were made by him. And if you turn over to Colossians, the first chapter, verse 16, it says this: For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. Now, who is this? They're talking about Jesus, that for him all things were created. So these things were created for him and for his pleasure. And we should understand that it really wasn't designed for our pleasure. Things were not created for our pleasure. They were created for his pleasure, that we would acknowledge him, that we would serve him, that we would follow him. And we're going to see that as we go along in the next few lessons, that Jesus is going to call these men to him, and he's going to say, come and follow me. And that's the same thing that he's saying to us today. Come and follow me. In him was life. Not only biological life. We have life. We have stuff that's going on that make us who we are, biological life. But the very principle of life, but the very principle of life. So not just biological, but the very principle of life, which encompasses everything. Knowing him, that this being filled and consumed by the Spirit, being led by the Spirit. That's what he said. I've come that you might have life and have it more abundantly, but you cannot really enjoy that if we are not, like we said earlier, the true sons of God, because we need to learn how to worship him too. That should be a major part of our everyday walk, worshiping him. The Greeks translate life mean the word Zoe, Zoe, which means the life principle. And I'm not going to get into a whole lot of theological discussion about the life principle, but the life principle basically is what are we all about? It's just not this shell. It's not what we're all about. We're about other things. And Jesus said this: And we all know that when he was 12 years old, he was they found, you heard the story about him being left in Jerusalem, and they found, 3 days later they realized he wasn't with them. And when they found him, he said, "Don't you know that I ought to be about my father's business?" And that's the same thing that we ought to be about too, is our father's business. And what is our father's business? It's that principle of life, passing that thing on, passing on the hope that lies within us. And you know what? And not and and being ready to give an account for the hope that lies within us. You know, somebody may ask you, somebody may say, "Hey, why are you so happy?" And be ready to tell them why you're happy. And don't tell them, lay it on them. And that'll either make them want to be happy too, or make them not want to ask you why you're so happy next time. But we're hoping and praying that when we begin to share the good news, that will draw people, to the Lord. The life was the light of men. It goes on that the life was the light of men. This is speaking of a spiritual light as well as a natural light. Now you say, "Well, what you talking about?" Well, this is what I'm talking about. That we are spirit, and we're flesh, and or carnal. Let me use the word carnal. And see, when we don't have a relationship or understand God, we have a carnal mind, meaning that we don't perceive and understand the things of God. But then when we have a relationship with Him, we become spiritual. When you're born again, you become a spiritual creature where we can understand the things of God. Because a carnal, in Corinthians, it says that it's foolishness to the carnal man. The things of God is foolishness. But when we have the enlightenment, like we prayed this morning, "Lord, open our eyes that we can see, and open our minds that we can understand," that when we have that type of relationship, that we become that spiritual person. So we're talking about two different types of entities that we wrestle and we struggle with that. The flesh versus the spirit. And the word says that in Galatians, how the spirit war against this flesh wars against the spirit. And so we need to understand that. So not the word contains life and light. He is life and light. We're talking about Christ. He is life and light. In other words, without Jesus, we would be dead and in darkness, and we would be lost. So can you, I mean, and I hate to keep reflecting where we were, but just as to give you an example that we were dead in our own transgressions before we met Christ. And my story was this, that I always found myself in a hole digging dirt. And as I put a shovel full of dirt in, I threw it over my shoulder. And so after a while, I had dirt in front of me and I had dirt behind me. And but when I met the Lord, He took me out of that and put me over here. And then he showed me. He said, "You can go back to that anytime you want. It's still there." And so it is. That hole is still waiting on me if I want to go back. So that's where we were dead to without Christ, without Jesus, we would be dead and in darkness. We would be lost. And man has a you know what? We have an inborn fear of two things, of death and darkness. And you think about that for a couple of seconds here. We have a just an inborn fear of death and darkness. But you know what? That he says that he's the light, that he's going to take away the darkness, because light expels darkness. And then he defeated death, hell, and the grave. So he conquered the two things that we fear a lot. Think about that. So he conquered those things. So you have to ask yourself, well, am I going to continue to fear death? Am I going to continue to fear darkness? And then you just have to make a decision that I'm not going to allow those things to have control over me. Let's read on. It says, and the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. In other words, it did not overcome it. So it's saying that darkness did not overcome the light. Light overcame the darkness. The word comprehend has a meaning of lay hold with the mind. So your mind just couldn't comprehend what's going on. See, when you're in that state, you don't comprehend how wonderful it is over here. You know, sometimes people say, you know, the grass is greener on the other side. But you won't know how wonderful it is on this side until you come on this side. And then once you get on this side, you're going to say, wow, you know. And you know, so that was my expression, wow, you know, because it is wonderful. Here's another point. As God, Jesus is the creator and the one who gives life to people. You understand that? That he is the creator and the one who gives life to people. And that life comes when he says, if you believe on me. You know, when you believe on him, all kind of things start to take place in your life. When you believe on him, that we have a new perspective on life. When you believe on him, that we're no longer walking around in darkness. We're not groping in the dark. You know, what just flashed in my mind was the scene back in Sodom and Gomorrah when the two angels went to Lot's house, Abraham's nephew Lot. Mm-hmm. And they went to his house, and it says that the people in that city were so living in such darkness that they were groping around in the dark. They couldn't find their way. You know, it's like they were blinded. You know, blinded to the truth, blinded to what reality was. They were self-deceived and self-consumed. Part two, the light. It's going to cover verses 6 through 13. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. Now, John was sent to bear witness of the light. And you remember, I believe it was last week, we talked about how they asked him, are you the one? He said, no, I'm not the one. And then they asked him, are you Elijah? No, I'm not Elijah. Are you the prophet? No, I'm not the prophet. So John just came to bear witness of Jesus. And that's what his purpose was. And he says this, that all through him might believe. Through Jesus, that we all might believe. We need to come and understand who Jesus is so that we can believe. Jesus is the Son of God. And then this is what happened. You know, when Jesus finished his work here on earth, he said it's done. And then he was highly exalted. When he went back to heaven, he was highly exalted. Mm-hmm. Now, you say, if he was God, how could he be highly exalted? Because the Father was well pleased with him accomplishing that task. He was highly exalted. And then it says this, that he was given a name that's above every name. And so you think about this. Everything that has a name, he's above that. And we're good at naming stuff. I mean, we'll put a name on. I don't even know where we get all these names from. You know, they used to have a book of names. And, you know, so expecting parents, they'll go get that book and, oh, what are we going to name our child? Or they want to know how many Pauls there are. And it's all kind of stuff. But we'll name anything. You know, we have a stuffed animal. And you name us your stuffed animal. You give your stuffed animal a name. And it's like, what? But my point is that everything that's named, and I can get into some examples like cancer and COVID-19, you know, I can get into things like that, but everything that is named has to come under the authority of Jesus Christ. And we need to understand that. The work of John was deliberately focused on bringing people to the faith in Jesus. And see, you remember they questioned him about why do you baptize then? If you're not if you're not Elijah, you're not the prophet, and the other guy, why are you baptized? He said, I just baptize with water, just to help people get ready, get your heart ready. So what John was saying is that what he was doing was just preparing the way to bring people to have faith in Jesus. Now, he was not the light, but he was sent to bear witness of the light. And John, John says, he says this about decreasing. I must decrease that he may increase. Because John fulfilled his purpose by being, when Christ came on the scene, John's work was done, really, because he came to bear witness of the one that was coming. He said, the one that's coming after me, he said, I'm not even worthy to untie his shoes. And so now John's work was done. So, I mean, John did, he accomplished what he was sent to do. Remember, we talked about the witness. And guess what? This is a serious thing. A person that stands in as a witness. And it's a sign of commitment too. A witness needs to be a committed person. You need to, when you stand in that witness box and you testify in that this is the truth. And guess what? And you are no longer neutral. At that point, you're not neutral anymore. That when you stand in as a witness. So John was not neutral. John came to bear witness to the truth and to testify that the one that's coming is greater than I am. He's going to baptize you, what they say, he's going to baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. I said, look, I'm just doing this thing in water, but look out, because your life is going to be drastically changed when he comes. Here's a practical point. Like John, we should bear witness to Christ, reflecting him to the world. I mean, what gives a reflection? Somebody send me some. I'm gonna say a mirror, a mirror. A mirror gives a reflection. So we should be able to mirror Christ. And you can't mirror him if you don't know him. You're going to have to build a relationship with him to be able to mirror him and reflect him. And you know what? When we're reflecting Christ, one of two things going to happen. We're either going to draw people or we're going to push people away. If one or two things going to happen. And we can't be neutral. Remember, as a witness, you can't be neutral. You can't straddle the fence. We can't walk on both sides of the fence. Now, some people try. And I tell you, I try. And it don't work. It don't work. You're either going to be on the left or the right. And that's matter of fact, that's what he says. That in the day, he gonna separate. He going to have a big separation. But for a while, he said, no, let them grow together. The wheat and the tares. Let them grow together. there's going to come a time for separation. For separation. And that time, it's coming. That was the true light, which gives light to every man coming into the world. So what does John mean about this? The reason anyone is born into the world is it concerns love and care. And you think about that. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. So the reason that we are here is so that we can, and like we talked about reflecting, that love, we need to be able to reflect that love. And we've talked about this many times about loving one another and the body building itself up in love. When it's well fitted together, it will build itself up in love. And so that's what we should be all about, is being able to reflect that, is to understand that we're here to show care and love, for our fellow man. Because the true light and the light that is given for the world. You know, it wasn't just given for me. You know, we say, ooh, look what I got. No. Jesus came for the world. And the work that he's doing is for the world, meaning that the people that in these countries that we never been to, we hear about them. Some of us never been to them. Some of we can't even pronounce some of those names. But guess what? He came for them too, mm-hmm. for the Germans, for the Russians, for the Chinese, for the Japanese, for the Americans, you know, for the Latinos. He came for everybody. And so the work that he's doing and the work that he wants us to do is not just restricted to just us. You know, and some people think that, hey, you know, me and my family, we saved. And they want to stop there. But no, let's not stop there. Let's keep going. Let's keep moving. Keep passing this thing on. Mm-hmm. John was pointing people to the real light. And the real light was Jesus. There he is. Pointing them to the real light. The work that John did was good, a good work. I mean, matter of fact, it was a great work. Jesus said this about John in Luke 7:28. He says, I tell you, among those born of women, there is no one greater than John. Mm-hmm. So Jesus acknowledged how great John was because the work that he was doing, I mean, was revolutionary if you think about it, because we need to understand that the New Testament hadn't started yet. You know, the New Testament really didn't start to after Jesus ascended. I mean, they were still under the law. But Jesus came to say, hey, I didn't come to destroy the law. I came to fulfill it. Mm-hmm. And so he came to fulfill the law. And then he says, look, now we under grace. We under the dispensation of grace. So that didn't happen until after Jesus left, that we started understanding what the grace of God was all about. Here's another point. Mankind's only hope is the truth that Jesus Christ, the true light, has come into the world. You know, and I don't know what you think, but this is what I think. That we'd be in a big mess if Christ hadn't come. We would. I mean, because remember back in the day of Noah, it says that in the days of Noah that men's thoughts were continually on evil. And you think about what's going on today. You know, are we heading in a direction where men's thoughts are and the evil is you know, the absence of God. Mm-hmm. You know, men, you know, we people are pleasure seekers. You know, they want everything is about, you know, getting some kind of thrill out of it. You know, let's focus on God. Let's get a thrill out of doing what we need to do with him. And you know what? And so what I said earlier, that abundant life, that we gonna learn how to live an abundant life once we get ourselves straight with him. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, the things that he would allow us to do never run out. Mm-hmm. I'm serious, never run out. You have so much stuff to do and you'd be like, ooh, wow. You know, and then you'd be trying to say, where I get all this energy from? You know, I mean, I talked to my auntie and she tells me that like on her Sundays, you know, her Sundays are full. You know, but I believe her every day is full, you know, but, and then you say, ooh, where you get all that energy from? And it's just like Jesus said, he said, hey, my meat is to do the will of the Lord. Mm-hmm. He's talking to the lady at the well. They're trying to figure out who gave him some food. They went off to get some food and he started ministering to the woman at the well. And so then they came back and they asked him, was he hungry? And he goes, nah, because he was doing God's will. Anyway, let's move on. The world did not know him. You know what? That's something. He created. Now, this is the one that created the world. He came home. Now let's put it that way. He came home and nobody welcomed him home. You know, and you know what? I was in the Navy, and you know, it's like coming home after being on a cruise, and you know, there's nobody at the pier to welcome you home. You'd have been gone for months, and everybody else has got somebody greeting them, and you don't have nobody greeting you. You know, so he came home. Do you find that strange that God came to the world he created? And the one and we were created in his image, and we didn't know him. He came and I mean, John was talking to the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the scribes, and these were the learned people. These were the people who should have known, who should have been watchful. They didn't know. They didn't. You know what they said? Crucify. Remember, we read that last week. Crucify him. And that's what they said. But then he went on to say, but as many as received him, to them gave he power or the right to become children of God. So, you know what? So I'm thinking about this. It's like you need permission to become a child of God. And you know what your permission is? Your permission is this. That to say, yes, I believe. I set that up here. He says, John says to believe in them. He said that they might believe, that all through him might believe. That's permission. I believe. So now you have permission to be called a child of God by believing. We need to embrace and receive him to ourselves. And you know, we all know about embracing. When we embrace something, we know what that's all about. But when it comes to following God, we only want to embrace him part of the way, or half. You know, I mean, can you imagine going halfway home? I mean, when will you get there? You know, but we need to embrace the whole thing of God. We do. We need to embrace him fully, you know, without any restrictions, because you know what? His love has no conditions on it. I mean, because remember, he loved us while we were still in sin. Now, if he had conditions on his love, then he would never loved us. He would never have sent his son to a world, a dying world, a world that was cracked. So there's no conditions there. So we need to stop putting conditions on how we embrace and receive him into ourselves. It says, to those who believe in his name. Remember, he has that name that's above every other name. You know, and you know what? And that's what I want to identify with. You know, and then you was that song. He knows my name. And then he knows your name. He calls you by name. And then sometimes he gives you a new name. I don't know, call me buddy. You know, because, you know, that's how we are. You know, sometimes he called me friend. That's how we are. What he call you? And you know what he calls you when you begin to talk to him, or when you begin to weep before him, when you begin to pour out your soul to him, or when you just sit back and you listen. You know, what does he call you? It says, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. Now let's break that down. John's gospel points out this. Not by blood. That's a physical birth. You know, I mean, you know, the natural birthing thing. That's physical birth. It says, not by the will of the flesh. That's sexual desire. You know, a fleshly thing, you know, that, ooh, you know, you get caught up in that. Says, not by the will of man. That's by any human volition. You know, and we got all kind of things out there. You know, the will of man. You know, I mean, it's amazing what man, you know, God, you know, he gave us these intelligence. You know, he did. And we got some smart people out there, and they be messing with this and messing with that. And we see it in how they reconstructed all our vegetables. I mean, I don't know what I'm eating. It says corn, but oh, I don't know. But anyway, we can talk about corn later. Practical point is this: those who receive Jesus' gift of salvation are born again as children of God. That is very significant right there. Because that's how he is our savior. He come to save us. He come to give us salvation. And we can't get that salvation till we become born again. As many as received him gave them the power to become the sons or the children of God. So we need to understand that's what it's all about, is coming to a place where we will live our lives for him. Put him, make him number one. Those little hands that people carry around at the football game, like that? Number one, yeah, make him number one. And when you make him number one, you're going to see all of the your life is going to change. It is. It's going to change. You're going to have just a whole new different outlook and perspective on things. Part three of this lesson, we're winding down. Verse 14. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And this was a strong revelation by John. This would have amazed, or this did amaze, really, when John was talking to the Jews and to the Greeks. These were the thinkers, the both they were thinkers, and the Greeks were the hearers. Ain't that something? I mean, that's like a whole different, I mean, they had a different perspective. I said that earlier. The Jews and the Greeks had different perspectives. The Jewish people were the thinkers. The Greeks were the hearers. And so what is he saying? The Word became flesh. And then he went on and broke that down a little bit too. The Greeks generally thought of God too low. To the ancient people, God, to their gods, the Greeks had gods like Zeus and Hermes, and they recognized them as supermen, and they were not equal to the order and the reason of the logos. Remember, the logos is the word of God. They were not equal to that, stating that the logos is you. The logos is you. You as in God. The logos is God. The Jews thought of God too high. The ancient Jews had a hard time accepting that the God revealed in the Old Testament could take human form. So they thought too high. Well, our God can't take a human form. The Word became flesh. And so the theologians say this, that Jesus had two apostasies or two natures. He had the human nature and he had the God nature. And even though he had the two natures, they didn't conflict with each other because he was here and he did what he had to do and without sin. He didn't sin. And all the things that he went through in the 33 and a half years, he didn't sin. So his human nature, and even when he got to the point where he may have struggled in the garden, say the Garden of Gethsemane, and he said, if there could be any other way, let this cup pass from me. And I can see that being a struggle, but then he said, but not my will, but your will be done. And so it was always, and he always talked about, I came to do the will of the one who sent me. Meaning that if he had his way, and I mean, and he could have, if he wanted to call legions of angels, he could have at any given time. So he was 100% human. He was 100% divine. And these two complete natures did not conflict with each other. The Word became flesh. And he took on a whole new persona by becoming flesh. He came to his own. He came home. And nobody knew him. Nobody knew him. Last practical point. It is through Jesus that we know God and see his glory. And we talked about this. I'm going to talk about it one more time. Jesus is the bridge. And he said, look, if you want to get to the Father, you got to come across this bridge. You got to come through me. And so he lets you know that Jesus, that through Jesus, that we get to know God and see his glory. So it's through him that we're going to experience the true worship of God, the true worship. I mean, and they that worship him, they worship God, must worship him in spirit and in truth. And Jesus said, look, I'm the way to get there. And remember the prayer that we read this morning? The prayer that we read this morning says this. The Lord says, I will guide you along the best pathway for your life. I will advise you and watch over you. So he wants us to get there. And we got to go through him if we want to see his glory. Thank you for listening. Mm-hmm. And I want to pray. And I want you to know that if you have any prayer requests, you can send them to me. Mm-hmm. I'll pray. I'll put you on the prayer list. Mm-hmm. Pray for you if you have any needs. A Helping Hand Ministry was able to provide meals for 5 families for Christmas this year. Maybe as time goes on, we'll be able to do more. But right now, we were able to provide just 5 meals. And I pray that those families that will receive those meals, that they'd be blessed. And we need to be praying about that because times are hard right now for a lot of folk. And God understands that. And he raises up ministries like this and other ministries to help meet those needs. And this is what he said, never have I seen the righteous forsaken or a seed begging bread. God knows how to take care of his own. And we want to just thank him for that. Father, thank you. Thank you for your love, for your grace, and your mercy. God, thank you for allowing us to look into your word today. I pray, Father, that you would do what you said that you would do, that you are the Alpha, you are the Omega, you are the beginning, you are the end, Lord. And right now, God, I just commit this time into your hands, and I pray for all of those who will hear this message, God, that you would touch them in a special way, that you bless them today, God, and let them know exactly who you are. But Lord, let them know whose they are. And I thank you so much in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless.